anybody care about the characters? And what can be salvaged or learned from the wreckage of an individual or a society? Nothing, remains. Why bother writing about such desolation? Gloom, doom, death, destruction, darkness, and despair. We're here to discuss this incredibly timely issue. And my name is Mary Turzillo, and you know, I won a nebula once, and I lost a nebula once, and it had destruction and despair in it and everything, but I don't even care about that. I've got a story coming out in analog called State Tartar and the Cats of Guard Vatican, and I've got a lot of cat stuff, and I've got a cat novel. But the thing I want to sell to you is this has a little teeny story of mine, but it's a really, really good anthology, and I'm hoping that it sells well. It's a wild site book, and I really hope it sells. You can order it on the internet from the wild site site or Amazon. It's a George Sithers collection of cat stories, and if you're into despair, you have to eat cats, right? So,
cats are really despair.
So, but do buy it, because I really want the second edition, the second volume of it to come out, because it's got a cat bowl of mine in it. So, anyway. My name is Mary Turzillo, if I didn't mention it. And I'll let the other panelists introduce themselves, the ones that are here anyway.
Hi, James Morrow here. I have lost a few nebulas in my time, too. Conspicuously, thanks to Orson Scott Card, his book, Speaking for the Dead, was up against my essay in despair, a novel called This is the Way the World Ends. And the title suggests that it's pretty bleak. I think there's sort of a strong form of unmitigated and utterly despairing and dark total loss of hope. And then there's the weak form of unmitigated despairing total form of loss of hope. And I do believe in the weak form. There's a valuable distinction. George Orwell gave us many years ago when he submitted the manuscript of 1984 in the year 1948 to this publisher in the UK. And of course, 1984 is about as what the adjectives
would be. Yeah, it's about as desolate and dark and beautiful as you can imagine.
And his editor said, "You must be kidding." Chris Morrow's time, tuberculosis at the time, Peter Gannon, we'll see the dark part of the totalitarianism that we respect. And the editor said, "Oh, we can't publish this. You know, we don't have the readers, will kill themselves." And Orwell had a very good answer. He said, "This is a prophecy. It's a warning. I don't think this is how the world has to turn out, but it might turn into a warning." So I'm on board with it. So I let it be a gloomy and dark and depressing as it needs to be. But let's try to frame it as a warning rather than a deterrent.
I'm Suzy Charnas, and my first book, a lot of people think of it as an exercise of despair, was Walk to the End of the World, and it was about the end of the remainder of our culture. And, you know, I was in my late 20s when I wrote that. And I think at that kind of age, there's a kind of hangover of the existential angst of a teenagerhood that you kind of can work out through fiction. And it's an exercise in, you know, look how awful I can see that things are. Oh my God, this is as far as I know. And it really doesn't mean anything because, you know, you're not 25 and you don't have any despair. You're just fine. But you can see terrible things in the world, especially in a culture like this where everybody keeps telling you how fine everything is and how rich we are and how happy and how we're the best in the whole world. It's very tempting when you're a young person in rebellious mode anyway to write something which says, no, we're not. And in fact, nobody is, and we're all going down the road to hell in a handcart. It's a lot different when you're up here, I'm pushing 70 now, and it feels a lot different when I write a story like that. There's a story in this little collection called Poe, and that I just put out. It's called Lowland. FMC, and it's my story is about, well, it's sort of redefining the mask of the Great Death, which is about the end of the world, I guess. But it's a lot more political and unkind than the first one was. I think it's more angry than show-offy, and less political in a gender sense, which the first book was. More political in a what the hell are human beings doing sense to each other and ourselves and our planet and all that stuff. You know, you go through this stuff and it doesn't get better. After a while, you write it again in a different form. I think it's hard to get out of that if that's the way you see the world. I see the dark parts, especially when people are telling you how hard it is. Although we don't get a lot of that reading. Yeah, yeah, we do. Just like it's insinuation. And I'm still reading the dark parts, and I'm not convinced. But of course, it's natural science fiction. It should be science. They say if this goes on, story, no longer pushes right to the end of the world. So we have a natural springboard in our genre. But it can be a habit of seeing it too, unless you really work to bury yourself from that.
Okay, I'm Joe Walton. I'm a cheerful, optimistic, positive person. That's why I wrote Father. And I looked at the topic of this panel and I thought, well, okay, so I want a panel on despair, the author of This Is the Way the World Ends, and the author of What the End of the World. And I don't know anything terribly depressing that you've done, but I thought, well, the authors of June the Obscure and The Sheep Look Up are dead.
So we will be too.
So clearly, you know, that's kind of bad. I try to maintain a positive outlook, but sometimes it's difficult.
Sometimes it's difficult.
Yeah. And one of the things that I learned writing Falling, which is a kind of depressing book, it's much easier actually to do dystopian. It's much easier to do dark and getting worse. It's a natural way that stories want to fall. And in trying to give the third book Half Crown a happy ending, I need to explain something. It was really challenging and not necessarily entirely successful. And I think, yeah, there's warning things if it's going on and that kind of thing. And I think there's also a pull within the force of story. There is a pull towards the dark things, towards visible things. Oh, here we go, Teresa.
I unchecked the apologize, I fell asleep in the back.
Just in time to introduce yourself.
You're in time.
You're just in time to introduce yourself. Because I was just finishing.
Hello, I'm Teresa Nielsen, case I'm late.
Runs away. And I, in preparation
I can never find it in a library again, that I honest to God sat there and cried for the last 120 pages. I read the whole thing. It was about a family where the son got leukemia, the six-year-old son got leukemia, and their oldest son had committed suicide. So these people, and this was the complete and detailed story of their son being essentially tortured to death by the medical community because they couldn't do anything for him. It was kind of leukemia that can't be treated. And so then I said to myself, Algis Buggers told me I had to write a happy ending for the story. I did. I won a nebula, but God, that was worth.
Do you think you would have won a nebula if you hadn't won a happy ending?
You know what? One of the critics that I got really positive, sold the first time off, the first editor I showed it to, it went, you know, straight to the nebula belt. But one of the critics said, well, the ending is too packed because she discovers a way out of her difficulties. And I thought, there's a lesson here, but I don't know what it is.
You know, there is a reward sometimes for writing really dark stuff. How many people here have read The Road, Woman McCarthy's
book?
Margaret Atwood's The Handmaid's Tale was originally not supposed to have that happy flame around it. It was also very grim. What about Bambi Meets Godzilla? Famous! Famous! There's an attraction.
So the answer is that endings don't have to be happy, they have to be satisfactory.
But different things satisfy different people. If you're a depressive person, you're going to say this is unrealistic. This little girl managed to find a way out of her predicament, and she was just a little girl, so fate should have crushed her, you know.
But if you're depressive, you're not going to play any other ending either.
That's true. But that's the thing. That I mean, people have different frames of mind.
I mean, there are not only happy and sad endings. There are also hopeful endings. There are endings that are hopeful without being. And there are endings that are despairing without necessarily being sad.
So if you're going to die, it'll take a while. Because that's a sort of a happy
ending. The hopeful ending to the leukemia story would be there's a cure, it may not work, but you can do it all at once, and maybe you'll be okay.
Exactly how that wrote the ending, but for some of that, I can't even remember. It was a very nice person who wrote it. I'm not complaining about the review at all, but somebody said, no, that was too bad. You know, she should have died, I guess. I don't know. And I keep thinking, well, this poor man, this friend, this, is terribly depressed about the state of the world, as I am. But anyway, I want to ask another question, which is, what's the most gloomy piece you've ever read?
Oh, she could have.
The Genocides.
Yeah. I've read The Genocides. And the Sheep Looker is the only book that ever made me actually contemplate suicide. I was on a boat in Greece, beautiful blue sky, and I was reading The Sheep Looker, and I seriously thought about just rolling off the side of the boat.
What do you call a decent sense of despair? It's sad to say you couldn't sustain the distinction indefinitely. Anybody would fault science fiction for settling, I guess, for unearned happiness. There's such a thing as the burning happiness, burning hopefully.
And the same with the other way around, the earned despairing ending. Because you can just kill everybody. Yeah, you for instance.
I really wanted, I thought the honest nuclear Holocaust novel would be one that spoke for victims and did not celebrate survivors. And while I was intrigued by and impressed with the other Holocaust fiction on the nuclear fiction that was coming out at the time, which they had been Russell Hope and Woodland Walker, they are nevertheless about survivors, and they're there for a client to identify the survivors. I want to have it both ways. If you kill everybody, you can have a narrator. So I have the sort of metaphysical trope of the unadmitted people who are also non-people. We only have a one-year piece.
How
do
you have a Christian priest?
No.
That's not so ask Mr. Fly Orwell this.
Yeah, I mentioned 1984. I think 1984 sort of hits the home run of despair. It's hard to improve on that.
What about me?
Yeah, that's pretty good.
What is a
hero? And I always thought that 1984 was funny.
Well, you can be funny and awful too. I mean, you know, gallows.
Yeah. Kafka was both funny and probably a pessimistic writer.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I heard Vonnegut, John Barth, Joan Keller. Joan Keller is funny as heck. But my God, Thomas Pynchon.
Flattery O'Connor thought her work.
Yes.
Thought her work was terribly funny. She couldn't. She had no trouble reading out loud because she would crack up.
And it is.
Yeah, I know. It's bracing kind of.
Okay, what's the gloomiest piece that you've ever written?
Oh, definitely Falling. Definitely Falling. Or maybe Hayden. But I wrote this cheerful little book with dragons that eat each other called Tooth and Claw. And people often come up to me in corridors and say, I love Tooth and Claw. I really liked it. And that really gives you a good feeling. And people often come up to me in corridors and conventions and say, Falling, look, you know. Well, that gives you a different kind of feeling.
For me, it's probably a little novelette from a novella called Listening to Brahms, which is essentially about the end of the human race, not the universe, but the end of us as the bearers of our culture, and some other creatures who take up the standard because they find us so enchanting, and carry on as we were carrying on. And somehow, I found that very thing that makes me laugh, and I didn't find it. Yeah, it's been in a couple of anthologies.
Well,
so some lizard people have been copying us.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, and the last few survivors end up in their world and gradually die off, which is what you do when you're the last few survivors and you're middle-aged people and you're in the sick of despair. Not mocking, not just mimicking. I think that's probably what it means, but it's funny.
But it's very funny.
It's a very funny.
With the novella that came out a couple of weeks ago, this is not exactly an advertisement. This is really a bummer. And that it's about this hopeless doomed from the beginning attempt to bring about Japanese surrender in the spring of 1945 through intimidation. It's analogous to the attempt that was almost there was talk about what if we could demonstrate the atomic weapon to the delegation from Japan. Might the Potsdam Declaration be ratified by the emperor as a function of the fearfulness of the weapon? And there were good arguments against it. The Assistant Secretary of War was employed and wanted the world to be told about his thing. The physicist Zillard thought we should not indulge in this sneak attack. So. I imagine a kind of parallel history in which the Navy's developed a super weapon, a biological weapon that happens to take the form of a giant fire-breathing bipedal mutant amphibious iguanas. that anticipates Godzilla. And they really do get Truman's permission to stage a demonstration. The plot has the demonstration taken the form of a juvenile behemoth, juvenile version of the Godzilla, destroying miniature city from the delegation. The Navy thought it would be pretty vivid. But it turns out that the dwarf behemoths are pussycats, they're much too docile. So they have to hire an actor to draw the form too. And it's sort of the point of view of an actor who's at a Hollywood party, just to read a couple, to get a Hollywood party. And he's looking at Hayden's, but his co-star's wife, and they're even more than him. And she says to him, "Be honest with me, Sims." And Sims told him, same cadence as long and shame. "Be honest with me, Sims," says Esther. "My visions are too bleak these days. They belong on the cover of Weird Tales." And Sims says, "Even as we speak, brilliant men contemplate the immolation of countless innocent victims through fire-breathing, sea-stopping behemoths," I told her, "compared with the desolation in the skulls of our admirals. Your visions belong on the cover of the sad region in the coast." I thought a lot about this problem of the earned happy ending, the gratuitous nihilism. And sort of, you know, cynicism can be its own sentimentality.
Yeah.
There can be a naivete. Dark Vision. I was very influenced by the book, and I was supposing this is the way the world is, by Freeman Dyson's book, which happened to have the word book in it, called Weapons in It, a book that still holds up. It's just a kind of affirmation that we must find, you know, the better angel of our nature. It's where I first ran into what I think is a marvelous sort of parallel metaphor for this, where it talks about the literary critic Clara Park. Her book about working with her daughter's autism. Clara Park's the mother, Paul Park. She'll be here because he's at Massachusetts Science Fair anyway. And oh yeah, okay. Clara Park in this novel about a brother in this nonfiction account makes sort of literary critics' point. She says, what are the touchstones of our culture? It's the Iliad and the Odyssey. And note that we can't think of them in any other order. And she goes on to say, you know, it's a grand claim we make when we decide that all fortune will come to nothing, that all, no human plan will prosper, that the only attitude that can command adult assent is, you know, here we are on the darkening plain, where Aryan armies clash by night, waiting for the arrow. And she says, you know, the Iliad and the Odyssey, yes, a terrible idea of destruction, death, unredeemed loss, but then the Odyssey of homecoming and the family being healed. And I find that a very compelling moment.
Right now by an English scholar, a business scholar, it's called The Delighted State, by name Thirlwell. It's a study of translation, techniques, and style. And he talks about all of the great books that I read when I was in school, from Don Quixote, from Stendhal, and all of those guys. And his point, I think, well, one of his points is a complicated and dense book, and I'm enjoying it tremendously, by the way. I think it's wonderful. One of his points is that Lawrence Stern, who's Tristram Shandy, I have never been able to read because it goes around and around, so it's
and it
doesn't go anywhere. Yeah, but he says that is essentially a tragic viewpoint, which recognizes the complete uncontrollability of life and the way it never goes where you think it's going, it always goes somewhere else, many different times and many where you thought you were going and then away again. Because that's the way life happens. It's fragmentary and crazed and uncontrollable. But that is also comic. And that's why those books that you're told they're funny, like Don Quixote is funny. Because the Don he succeeds half the time. This guy totted it all up and he said, half the time he actually succeeds, half the time he fails. But the point is, it never works the way he wants it to work. And that is essentially a tragic vision, which is not tragic in the sense of, oh, whoa, despair, but in the sense of, shit, I'm never going to get there. It's never going to be the way I imagine it should be, the way we plan it's going to be, the way we wish it to be. always going to be nibbled away at by anything that occurs in this going to be something else.
The most
joyful
and most interesting maybe any of the questions. I'm just going to show them with the following, with the sediment of the citizens, is how anybody can keep reading when a character is completely mired in disaster and despair. What is there interesting in that situation when you're already at the bottom?
Is there some intrinsic suspense to that? Well, the character, if the character doesn't get out
of
it, yeah.
Much more poignant than if he realized that death is permanent and that his friends are dead.
that chaos is the unexpected, to think that it's always going to be awful is statistically improbable. And in my experience, you know, my life has been full of a great many unexpected things, but some of them have been wonderful and nothing I could have imagined. The world is full of people who are having terrible lives, and this is true. And they will suffer to no good end. They will be injured in ways that are irreparable. They will become less, you know, they will become depersonalized, and they will come to sorry ends. And this is a true thing. And it's something that, of course, we're all, that's the terrible condition that we're all trying to escape from, to make a better world where that doesn't necessarily happen. To write about it, that is interesting. I mean, to write about it, well, generally is to deny that it's the state of the world, because when that happens to people, they don't generally, you know, they're not in a position where it's got it. You do hear from other people. We're all on middle ground. We do not live in a world that is entirely good. We live in a world that is entirely horrible. And everything that we have to do right now could just fall into some hideous end that we completely anticipate.
It's not a rough fact in the world. We do measure suffering against a ground that is not certain, it's chaotic, against some sense that things are grounded in the predictable, the way it ought to be.
But we all die.
And we may be making it up in order to fight.
We may all die. And what do you got to do with that intermittent, with that interval?
What you just said about this stall and run stall, this stall, yeah. So you're making a positive act to see that dog as bad, yeah. Because actually, further away, there are more stalls. And you know, maybe 8 years, but also really cool things. And I actually wrote a poem a few years ago, after my four died, I did a thing on my life journal where if people donated a certain amount to the library fund that we're doing for him and his memory, I would write a poem on the subject of their choice. And somebody asked me to write a poem on the subject of eucatastrophe. Catastrophe. And so I wrote this eucatastrophe poem about the defeated doggle. Withdrawing to fight another day, taking all the dark with him. And nobody had any shadows. And when the night came, it wasn't going to get dark. Only his purpose was defeated at the last moment, and he came out. And there's a line in it, I'll do my oldest job and the line. But he has to come out, and the dark spreads through the light and mingles, and is redeemed. And the light and dark redeem each other. And without the dark, the light is inane.
Sure, it is the poem that you know by heart.
No, it's in the new collection it's mega long anyway. But in the end, the light and dark redeem each other, because the light on its own is smug and inane and cliché, and the dark on its own is hiding in a chest and plotting evil. And together, you've got the beauty of the night sky.
Also a story.
As a new story, and a new catastrophe, which is what I was supposed to be doing. And I think you can look at the dark sky and go, it's dark. And only little pinpricks of light, and there we are against it, and we're all going to die. And you can say, well, we're all going to die, and the worms will eat us, and then other people will eat the worms, and then we shall all have envy. and that kind of view of life. And you can also think, I don't think there's ever been a time when I've gone on a plane without thinking, well, if it falls out of the sky, I'm dead, and I guess there are worse times to go. And I know I thought that coming here. I thought, oh, you know, everybody in Boskone would really miss me.
But the books, cover of Logan.
Yeah, the book's done, and I'm going to be But all Bruce, and I guess I resigned to this because it didn't fall out of the sky, and here I am. I think it's possible to have a sort of fairly positive outlook about the fact that we are all going to die.
And once you're dead, you're not. I think it's not a problem. That's for you.
Exactly.
Argument that death gives life to death. Knowing that we have such a brief tenure, God knows what does. I'd be too philosophical. I don't know Woody Allen, I don't want to achieve mortality to my children and my book. I don't want to achieve immortality and I'm dying.
But that's we don't have a control group planet Earth where people don't die. We can't interview them and say, are you happy or not?
That was a lovely thing. Well, I think I'd get bored with immortality, but I'd be prepared to try it for 800 years. If I didn't like it a lot.
Yeah, I mean, that's much of what I write was about what I regard as sort of the obscenity of the death of a child. About half of my plots are involved in the intent of that. Usually doesn't just save the trouble from premature. That's kind of what I cannot reach a truce with that aspect of the cosmos. And I think it's pornographic to try to rationalize it through any theodicy, which is why theodicies seem to be written by the devil. I got something in embryo. I might be from it tomorrow. It's a novelette called I Won't Be a Cramble. It's called The Raft of the Titanic because I couldn't stand the tragedy of that. I think I came out of the Cameron movie or some experience with that and saying, well, maybe it didn't need to be this way. And particularly the death of children. You know, I'll tell anybody who wants to get sentimental about the Titanic and say, well, it just shows what out in the ability of the English people. I'm sorry, more upper first cabin, first class men, got into those lifeboats and were saved than children from steerage. So it's not an uplifting parable. But in my version, I said, the problem is not that it was a light belt, it's not a trial. The problem is the temperature of the water, build a raft.
Did you find yourself during the James Cameron movie like sizing up all the stuff that got down in the hole, hold it?
There's a tavern that's called built by the White Star Lines at the same time. It's called the Adelphi, and we're from the Eastern Continent. So I spent the whole James Cameron movie going, they're sinking my cop. and also, every time we got to the interesting people in the steerage, they would cut back the awful stupid main characters. I would get irritated.
Yeah,
There's a study of the people who survive airplane crashes. You know what it shows? Most of them are large, healthy men. I read about that and I thought, oh shit, I know what that means. And when you talk about the Titanic, it's exactly the large, healthy guys, they cannot help themselves. They shove everybody else out of the way. I've also heard from a friend of mine who's an expert on the military, he says, when you read those stories about the guy who throws himself on the grenade to save his buddies, he's always the littlest guy in the group. What is that to? So if he wasn't despair, there's lots to go around.
I was tempted once I put everybody in the raft of the Titanic to go to the darkest place I can imagine and say, now it's going to become like a raft of Medusa and the Antarctic. No, that's not sufficiently fun. It has a different sort of thing. I think equally perverse. But I thought, no, that is the kind of facile one.
Part of the problem for me, though, it's not just the deaths of children or the deaths of people. When I read a lot of naturalism, a lot of stories about animals, a lot of observations of nature, and when you you stop and actually think about what goes on in nature from second to second in terms of raw brutality and suffering, it is unbearable. And what people suffer to me is somehow it's not so bad because we can think about it, kind of, and sometimes we can change it a little, but with creatures in the wild, they can't change anything. It just keeps happening and it never stops and it goes on and on. It's that saying, you know, what the dead things do to life. It's an energy exchange system that works in the most brutal way possible. And when I want to feel really bad, I think about that. When I want to feel good, I think about us finding ways to struggle against that.
So Darwin would be very aware of
that. So this is an observer. I remember somebody was waxing romantic about the wolves in the wild, and I said, look, I just read a study. You know what the average life expectancy is in the wild? It's 4 years for a wolf. That's a predator, a big, strong creature. Because the rate of injury is so high for predators.
Lions.
Some do.
Male lions kill the cubs. We're not sired by them. And well, nobody takes them to court.
It's the grounds of the experiment about that because it's not modified. Except for among those creatures which we take under our wing and we give protection to.
Well, we
need
to get more wolves.
That's not what we've been doing.
No, but we have more and more.
If we kill enough of them, the ones that are left will take care of
them.
But
we'll kill them nicely. We'll kill them nicely.
That's better.
The raccoon pies.
I'm sure.
Comment threads of every one of us.
TSA or Department of Homeland Security or something like that. And I was getting a weird bunch of comments in the thread of people explaining how it was the victim's fault. And they were stupid, they were naive, they seemed that obviously the harmless thing they did would be taken that way. And it's necessary to do these things to people in order to keep us safe, et cetera. And people would make up quite elaborate scenarios to justify how it was right for authority to do this. And I was like, what the hell is going on here? Because it was that, you know, that same kind of yo-ho, tough-minded kind of thing that you get with the kind of very bad sort of quasi-optimistic or already science fiction. And I think what finally I figured it out there was an entry about the mortgage crisis with all these people losing their homes. And the comment thread, duly, you get the same recourse there, explaining how they were stupid and greedy, and they were just speculators, and they deserved to lose their homes. So I'm thinking, some people just buy houses to live in them, yeah. And then a little time after that, there was a story about how the homeless were sneaking them into empty homes in Florida that had been vacated by people because they lost their mortgages. And these people were quietly and very tightly living there so that they'd have a shelter. And suddenly in the comment thread, these same recourses was explaining how this was these horrible and an affront, and all of a sudden the people who lost their homes to mortgages became solid and respectable homeowners and how they got the name of such a horrible thing. And it finally came to me is that what they were saying over and over again is, this isn't going to happen. I wouldn't be stupid, I wouldn't be naive, I wouldn't be greedy, I wouldn't be any of those things. What they're saying is this disturbs me, I want to be good, this cannot happen to me, and therefore they do it by blaming the victim and pretending that they're being tough minded.
And I think in an honest story, you've got to think it could be you're the animal, not I'm too clever to go the animal. Come lose my house, become homeless,
and the reason,
mortgage,
the reason,
be the hustle, whatever, yeah.
The reason, I mean, I'm not, the cold equations is not, you know, literary, I'm not claiming that, but the reason it makes sense to make the character a girl that sacrificed is because then the reader, who was probably more likely to be male, thought, oh, that could be my girlfriend. They never think, oh,
well,
that
could be. When I was researching my Armageddon, I looked at Arthur Coppock's play called End of the World, and it has an astonishing climax. It's called End of the World with a symposium to follow. But very briefly, the viewpoint character is a journalist who's sort of trying to fathom the arms race, and it's kind of indictment of reading or princemanship. And he engages in a kind of confessional, and then he says, under what circumstances might one day happen? And he talks about how when his wife, he had had a baby 3 years earlier, the baby's only about 3 weeks old, he's alone with the child, babysitting, mom's away, but sitting there alone on the 16th floor of a Manhattan apartment, the windows are open. He says, I love this child more than anything. I love my wife more than anything. This is the best thing that's ever happened to me, this child. But, what a thrill, you know, knowing. And he's looking at you as I'm like, I could do it, but I could never get that baby back. And what a perverse thrill he had. And so the character confesses, just sitting there with the baby, that he had to walk over and close the door. And he says, if doom comes, that's how it
will come. This is really, the time is over. And the audience never got to say anything. They were very polite. I think they were probably sitting there, you know, in the depths of despair.
There's no panel after this one here.
So, I don't know. Anybody want to say a final word?
No.
A really final word.
River otters.
plus size. You have to finish that. I haven't even got time. There's no deadlines for it at all.
I'd be happy to stick around for 10 minutes. Yeah.
Okay, if people have actually got questions.
No questions. I'm going to say, as a guy, I got to be on a panel with four women. That gives me hope.
Very large but not infinite white room, and he was in it. So you do not get, because we've got here two eyewitness accounts, okay, that I've heard from him and from you, and they're not the same. He wasn't floating around and feeling wonderful.
I didn't say that there wasn't
a but you said you were floating around and feeling wonderful, and he said that he was standing in a very large, but not infinite room. And those are kind of different near-death experiences. So you can't say that you know what death's like, only that you know what your near-death experiences are like. Because Ken's near-death experience was kind of different. And while I wouldn't mind the floating about a bit, though actually I think I'd rather be alive, the standing in a very large, but not infinite white room doesn't sound like very much fun.
He was in the wrong room. He was in the wrong room. The family died of cancer, reported just as she was heading in. She was in a white corridor. And there was a door at the end of the corridor. There was a sign that said, this way out. And on the other side of the wall, she could hear a lot of women laughing. And all right, they convinced me.
It is worth making a distinction between a near-death experience and the death experience. Because otherwise we risk, I'm not saying that's what you're doing, we risk trivializing. It'll suck in. Yeah. Nobody's going to say, well, let's see if we can recapitulate the Great War post haste. I think we're all prepared to say. It's a cosmic injustice when a child dies and he was there.
Yes. Yeah. We've got three hands up, and I think we should answer these and then stop. Okay, so you were first.
When you write a This Is the Way the World Ends or Father, are you then in a bad mood for the rest of the day? Would you have to go out and smell flowers or something to get back to normal?
Well, it was tough. I had bad dreams. And the article when I was composing it, there were actually more about the Nazi death camps than visions of nuclear Armageddon because of the precedent under which they conduct the trial of the plot of the Suzy is more precedent. Yeah, I had to give it a framing story, sort of like the different Job, and the framing story allows for it being a story. But it was rough, because I did envision the death of my own child. Every parent's worst nightmare. I think we all have ways of writing those kinds of stories in a way that will permit us to step out of the room, because otherwise we wouldn't write the next one. We'd find a way. I think everybody has their own ways of doing that. You write it in such a way that you give yourself an escape path.
Yeah. And anyway, you're writing it. You're already writing it. I have been upset by things that I've written, but I'm writing it. There's a layer in which I'm making art. I've been more distressed by things that I've read and watched and so on, because they're just coming straight at me and I'm getting the full impact. Because there isn't any about this. And you know, when you're writing it, you could always go and change it. You are in control.
There's a movie made in Britain called Threads. You know it,
yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
You want a little despair to look at that. That's a killer movie, and that's the kind of thing we're talking about. It comes at you,
yeah,
and there's no way.
It's
just
Threads. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just
awful.
Okay, wrong.
You mentioned The Sheep Looked Up as a despairing novel that induced thoughts of suicide. I mean, John Fitterall's three or four novels in this style are all dystopic in one way or another. Was that the only one that had that effect on you?
I think all the others are actually, no. I think Stand on Zanzibar and The Shockwave Rider have positive endings, and they are relatively comparatively positive worlds. Thingy, The Jagged Orbit, the last time I read it, I really couldn't get with it at all, but I remember originally reading it and not finding it particularly depressing. It's not as good a book. It's the total destruction of the entire environment and all the people at the end of The Sheep Look Up, in which the happy ending of The Sheep Look Up is the whole US is destroyed.
Yeah.
You know, really. And there's a line in it about the cesspool of the Mediterranean, you know, when you're sort of actually on the Mediterranean at the time. That's kind of, yeah. Avram?
Mentioned earlier a story in which, you know, death, there was no death. I just realized that one of the deepest stories I've ever read was this really bad comic book in which some weird disease had rendered everyone in the world immortal. Not just unaging, but physically indestructible.
Yeah.
So there was mass overpopulation. The only way the government could punish people was by knocking them in coffins and firing them into war. There's a scene that a character is a cop and she finds someone who's illegally given birth. She's so pissed off, she just grabs the baby and bludgeons the woman to bed. Which doesn't actually hurt either of them.
It's a really good example of how death is not in fact the worst thing. Yeah, thank you.